back to the checkpoint. I am here with two gentlemen, me Vivian Kamsime, with Brother Lutaya, who is the headmaster of Mugwanya Preparatory School Kaboja, and Mr. Patrick Kavoyo, who is the National Secretary for FENEI, which is the Federation of Non-State Education Institutions. And we are discussing the school fees hike that has been on since this term started, because the term actually started last week. And gentlemen, to be very real or actual in the situation, there are parents who may not have taken their school, their children to schools as we speak right now. Reason, they're still looking for the money. And they could have gotten some school fees, but then the requirements money is there too. How should these parents manage at a time like this? How would you advise their brother?
I don't want to be hard on my parents. I've already told you that I wish we had absolutely 100% free education in this country. It would have solved all these problems.
Now like, that we don't.
Like it has done in so many other countries.
Now that we don't, now brother, that look we here. Don't. We have a situation
I'm
where
coming.
Government has said no fees hikes.
I'm coming to that.
And the schools say, we are hiking them.
Yes. No,
and they go ahead and
by
do that.
By the way, we are not hiking. I'm in charge of discipline and professional ethics in the whole of Wachiso District. Wachiso District has, as far as I know, the highest number of schools in this country.
Yes.
And I'm in charge of, where I hear parents complaining, I'm almost the first one to be called upon. Teachers complaining, whatever, any problem in any school, I always move to, even to the islands of Wusi, to Namayumba. All these, Wachiso District incidentally has got some of the biggest and best schools in this country.
Yes.
And some of the worst there, some children studying even under trees in some
very
areas of
Wachiso
District.
There.
So what I know what I'm talking about. I've seen all of this. For instance, you are talking of government, what Mr. Kawe was saying, that government gives us whatever we need. I've never seen a single structure at Kaboja, and almost all schools of our standards of government. I've been in that school for quite a number of years, a long time. And I always ask the district, there's what we call SDG, okay?
Yes.
SDGs, school development grant. And many schools, when you look at the list of the district, there are so many every time, and it is very true, the government gives out this money, and they are constructing schools. But now, for us, they tell us one thing. You look at all these children who are studying under trees. There is no way we can leave, we can leave a school where children are studying under trees, and we give Kaboja a structure. Yeah, what kind of structure shall we give you? Because you are constructing whatever, storied buildings. Let me tell you, stop constructing storied buildings in schools of our standards. Kaboja, Budo, Savio, Namiriango, these are the traditional schools. Mm. And these are the ones the districts are proud of that are giving them good results, okay? Where they say, well, UP schools are not performing, we are really trying our best to catch up with these people in the private sector. Now, for us, they say we cannot. The standards of our structures that we are constructing according to this school development grant cannot match your standards, okay? I know we have had some standard structures, a number of them at my school, and we are just breaking them down so that we match with this. These are parents who can't say, oh, the first storied building we put up at Kaboja, I used to see parents calling everywhere. You come and see. We now have storied buildings here. And within no time, numbers had increased. You know, this is the problem. We have a free market economy. What we call a free market economy in our country. That, clients sway. There is a way they are playing around with these issues of demand and supply.
And supply.
And they really determine demand and supply. For parents, to go back to what you were telling me, to be sincere, there are many, many schools here where the government is doing their best, and they can't raise school fees because the government knows the government is there almost 100%. They are giving the structures, they are building the structures, they are telling these parents, please, if you can't afford these schools where the costs are really high, please take your children to these schools. And
very interesting. Let me just bring in Patrick here.
Can accommodate all those children that you are saying are at home. Parents want very high standards. And they don't know. Mr. Kabeo has said really quality comes with a cost. And they want quality, but they don't want to pay for it. But there are those who are very much willing. To be sincere, I thought we are going to have very few children. And I was telling stakeholders in our school, say, I would be comfortable moving with 500 children in the school.
Which
here.
Is half
yes,
of your population.
Half the population.
In the school.
That can really accept to meet the costs, because now I have no other than just locking up the entire school, which is a huge school around. We have so many structures. I said, can we move? Of course, when we reduce on the number of children.
So, in short, what you're trying to say is that some of these parents still have the children at school at home because they want to take them to schools that pay
that don't match
their standards.
Their standards of income. Okay. I don't want to repeat these words of the late Professor Hajibi, he's now late, but head teachers used to quote that. I don't like the statement where the late Professor Sendezak Hajibi used to say, if you find education expensive, try ignorance. Because there is no investment. Our people are investing in so many, many things. Is there an investment you can make that is more valuable than the investment you can make in your child? And some of our people are simply greedy. They don't want to invest in their children. They have the money and they're just refusing.
Really?
I'm shocked. I have more children than those who have increased the school fees, but I have more children than even those I had last year. The school is full up. I thought we're not going to get children.
Very interesting and controversial
situation
here. We don't have where
to put these children. We are just telling them, please try some other school. We are full up.
I want to bring in Patrick.
The parents are there. There are parents who are willing really to invest in their children because they know the value of education.
Okay. So Patrick here, most private schools have been accused of asking for very many or unreasonable, non-reasonable requirements like reams of paper. They are very specific about the quality, the books, a number of pens and pencils. And parents have to dig deeper in their pockets to pick some good sums of money to pay for these things. And the question is, how many books could a child or a student use in a school? I mean, in a term? Because at the end of the day, you're going to end up having these books or reams of paper or brooms, brushes, being sold on the market.
Thank you. Before I answer that, I want to pick it from where brother ended.
Yes.
That the students are now enough, they have. And some of those are referred to other schools. And this is the time I ask government to really think of coming out of the box. Because government does not need to be relevant, it is relevant. It doesn't need to be present, we know it's there. Now, the types of schools are three. One,
yes,
purely government. Two, private. Three, grant-aided or government-aided.
Yes.
Does government at this time need to be seen speaking the story of grant-aiding? No. Mm-hmm. It should leave foundation bodies run their business. If it wants to
isn't
grant
that privatizing education, the education sector completely?
Not completely. It should categorize that for us as government, we have our own schools.
Mm.
And the private actors have theirs. And the foundation bodies have theirs. Then it comes for regulation.
If I would be allowed to chip in.
Maybe later a bit.
Yes. Okay.
But in terms of the question you asked about books, number of books to use.
Yes.
COVID gave us the SOPs, the standard operating procedures. We have a curriculum which is delivered with a syllabus. And you know that in the syllabus for term one, which started in February and sometime in April, I'm supposed to teach a number of lessons with a number of pages written depending on the content I'm giving in terms of exercise or notes. Mm. But good teaching is not filling the books with a lot of notes. The students should be able to understand, comprehend, and apply what you are teaching. Meaning that for any school that writes too much, it is not doing very good teaching. But a school which thinks that should have too many books.
Repeat that again.
A school that prides itself in too much writing in the children's exercise books,
yes,
is not offering good teaching.
Very
instead, the learner should be able to understand, take their own notes. And if they take the notes or they do research, they are not going to fill a lot of pages in their books because they will be writing key issues, key points which will stick. Meaning that definitely the books they are asking, or we are asking, or he's asking, should be commensurate to the syllabus catalog that there is for every teacher to teach.
So what happens in those cases where you have these books piled up somewhere in the store, the school store, the books, the reams of paper, the brushes, the brooms, and then the toilet paper rolls that are asked for by the school, then you have them being sold on the black market?
As the Federation, we are concerned on that,
yes,
because we want equality.
That's very true.
We don't want to press or to show like we don't know that. It happens, yes. And it has happened by having learners report that they are in the washrooms or toilets or latrines without toilet papers.
Yes.
And
they,
when toilet paper was brought.
Yes.
So that has to be an area of improvement. The same applies to brooms. But again, when I reflect on this conversation, those who are listening to us from upcountry, where there are no toilets, but they have latrines.
Pit latrines.
Also have to join in the conversation to know that what applies here should also be the same to apply in their context. So when we have the requirements asked for, they should be rationally measured to fit into the context of teaching and learning, but not to bear the face of an extortionist kind of thing that,
yes,
every parent thinks I'm being ripped. And for us, from our leadership, this is going to be a concern. And from the other side, that I also do engage in research. I've already had a meeting with the deputy director of the National Bureau of Standards to really establish these facts based on standards that are scientific. How long should a pen last if I'm using ink?
Yes.
How long should ink last in a pen? Yes, a brother might be laughing, but we,
yes,
have already had a meeting.
We have to get
if the deputy director is listening.
I see yourself going into the issues of measuring how much toilet paper.
Not really. Let me tell you, somebody failed an interview. Was good for an interview, did everything, passed, wowed the panel, but failed when he went to use the toilet. They timed him, they put a roll, they knew how it was getting off, they saw how much he rolled and how he left it. They came to confirm that this one with the resources, he won't manage. He has mismanaged the toilet paper. Off, he lost the job. So it's not a simple matter.
So that's where we are getting to. A brother wanted to come in at the point of how the sector is regulated by the government when you're talking about the three different categories of schooling. Can you go on with your take?
Now, I will always insist that life avoids extremes. What I see, particularly with our active media,
yes,
today, is that there is a lot of truth that you try to project to the public, as well as some exaggerations. And this affects the public and the lawmakers very, very much. You will get, I know there are cases, really indisciplined cases. We have arrested some. We have, dealt with quite a number of indisciplined cases, at least in Wachiso District. I know that very well. And there is a lot of supervision. I think there is more supervision today in schools by government than ever before. We are audited every academic term, without fail. These are government auditors, and then we have private auditors auditing us, and there is a lot of holding up that these people are doing. Mm. When you see schools doing what they are doing, and you see everybody seems to be now confused, we don't know how to go ahead. There was what you mentioned there, that that was putting a cap on school fees.
Yes.
And then at the end of the day, it is not working.
Implemented.
It's not being implemented. Now, all this is because some people capitalize on certain samples, and they generalize those samples. I say, life avoids extremes. Virtue stands in the middle. They are extremists. There is no way I can really expect a day school, to be sincere, a day school charging more than a boarding school, a fully boarding school. You can't just imagine it. Yet this is what is happening. Almost all day schools around town here, all day schools worth the name school, are charging more than the boarding schools are charging.
Yes.
Traditional boarding schools are charging.
Yes.
Probably we are helped a little bit by this 7 million I'm getting, which is at one point I saw there is a lot to do with that money from UPE. I said, but do we really need absolutely this money? Because it has a lot of tasks to account for it. And at one point I said, can we leave this money? Can we give it up? And I was told, please, that's the only way the government comes into your school as a government aided school. There is no way you can reject it. Yes, they are paying our teachers. I have 50 teachers in all. There is a ceiling on what the government can pay depending on the number of children you have. Now my ceiling is at 29 teachers. But for quite a long time, the government was paying 21, was giving me only 21 teachers. And the parents were paying more.
So you had to cover up for the remaining.
Yes, and even those
our
paid by.
Our time is first spent, brother.
Okay.
Maybe I could just have your last take on the topic. Advice to the government.
I would advise that we concentrate, we insist on sensitizing the children, the parents, about their rights in the schools. To me, the first stakeholder, the prime stakeholder in a school is the child, and the second one is the parent. The parents determine usually the pace of the school. You have seen so many schools being sold up. By the way, have you tried to remind, have you asked yourselves, why are so many private schools being sold up right now? They're selling them up left and right. Others are being turned into hotels and all that, simply because these are people who are really genuine, but they couldn't catch up.
Okay.
With the pace of our economy, the way our economy is moving. And they are those who will say, okay, let's have the little we have. Let's do with the little we have as we wait to see where we are going. But again, they will also end up, increasing tuition. But there are also those who are simply cheating the parents. That is very true. We need to go for case by case.
So the parents you get should one, be able two, three. To identify when they are being cheated.
Yes.
And then run away.
Yes, and they should
Patrick,
always.
Can we have your last take on this? And especially to government that has asked you private schools not to hike the school fees, but then you have gone on to do that.
Thank you so much, Vivian and the brother and the viewers. Is it sustainable? It's not. Reason being that you can try, but for it to see the life. It's a difficult thing. But also if the country is in middle income status and we are there, then cost sharing shouldn't be an issue. So we should share the cost and improve education. Policies should be properly thought about, people involved, discussions held, dialogue sustained to arrive at what we want to deliver. The right to education is just one small sentence in the Constitution. It should be expanded to detail what other components should escort a mere statement. Every person has a right to education.
Not even right. And so what? Fundamental.
Thank you, gentlemen.
It's a fundamental
right.
Right,
having you for this discussion. We do have to go, even though the parent who is watching us on the other end has got to find solutions on how their child will be going through school this term. That has been the Checkpoint this week with me, Vivian Kamsimi.